lovers and lovers and swingers, it's the end of the week. This is the only thing between you and the pillow. It's time to hit a big note on the band flute. It's time to fiddle, giggle, wriggle. It's time to Club Buggery. Tonight, This Morning Life presents Club Buggery, live from the 1965 Nissan Centric 1900 showroom here at the ABC Studios in Gore Hill. Club Buggery, featuring vocalists extraordinaire, the Nissan Centrics.
There's an old saying, and we always use, don't expect that the Centric less than the best. Me and Danielle, I feel that we lose, whenever we fail this Nissan Centric test.
Supported by Australia's Rolling Stones, on skins Mr. Charlie Watts. On bass, Mr. Bill Wyman. On guitar, Mr. Keith Richards. On trumpet, Mr. Brian Jones. On sax, Mr. Ronnie Wood. Keyboards, Mr. Mick Jagger! And now, would you please give a big pants off, hawked out, pumped up, Club Buggery welcome to those two vultures of variety, the killers of cabaret, those lairds of Las Vegas, rampaging Roy Slaven and H.G. Nelson!
Until something happens, ladies and gentlemen, you just save it, please, ladies and gentlemen. Sit on the hands for a minute. Hello, Australasian buggers. Welcome to Club Buggery. I should thank, of course, the Stones, the Cedrics and Terps. The warmth of the welcome blew me away, to be quite honest. And welcome to Club Buggery for another Friday night, and thanks for joining us on an evening when too much variety will be barely enough. And tonight, Club Buggery comes to you from the 1965 Nissan Cedric 1900 showroom here at the recently refurbished ABC headquarters at Gore Hill, refurbished on a budget of zero. And now let me introduce to you a man who this week said, yes, 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 I am prepared to be buried in Jeff Kennett's death world or world of the dead. I don't mind what he calls it because it's a top idea. Rampaging Roy Slaven, who or what has been dancing D-style before the dimming footlights of your mind this week, pal?
Yes, thank you very, very much, H.G. Nelson. Lisa Curry Kenny is in my mind this week, having come back in the short course, I think, in Adelaide.
Very slow pool.
Very slow pool. And Lisa was even slower than the pool. She came last. But I don't think she should be discouraged.
No, neither do I.
I don't. But if you are going to make massive changes to your superstructure, vis-a-vis implants, how can you expect to be as quick as you were? I mean, those implants, they weigh you down. She was having trouble breathing. She was having trouble staying afloat. They had to pick her up off the bottom of the pool in the deep end, give her Sylvester Brosh and mouth to mouth, and said, "You're last." But I wish her all the very best in the world. I say, welcome back, Lisa. Actually, we should talk about the fight.
Oh, yes, the fight, yes. Look, on some television screens around Australia, both of us might be appearing a bit larger of head than normal. Well, it is true, there's been a bit of a stink at Club Buggery, but we've sorted it out, and I think the rest of the night will be tickety-boo from now on.
Oh, I think so. That's people are concerned about the change in the superstructure of the face.
Yes, that's right.
Vis-a-vis
that's right.
Punching the head. Yes. But the other 15 blokes you should see there.
And with that as a way of setting the scene here in the showroom, it's time to welcome a man who spent his entire life making horses go as quick as buggery. Nissan Cedrics, can you take the side of the Flemington Grandstand and a 44-gallon drum of Brett Whiteley's favourite colour, cobalt blue, and have a go at the Lee Freedman story?
Man.
coming in, Lee. Now, you're having what's euphemistically described, I think, in the racing trade as a bit of a holiday at the moment. You come back, I think, on September the 15th, Craigley Stakes Day.
Ninth,
sorry, a week ahead, a week behind. It's been one of those weeks, Lee. I'm sure it's been one of those months for you. Now, look, how have you been spending your time? Has there been a list of jobs on the fridge, like cleaning out the gutters, mowing the lawns, repainting the fence and all that sort of stuff at home?
There has been.
And how far have you got?
I found a very good fella to do it.
Right. And while you're away having this holiday, do you think horses? Do you wake up in the middle of the night and think, ah, I've got the secret at last of Kabora? Or Superimpose, if only I'd run him in the cocks? Or things like that. Do you keep thinking horses?
No.
Do the horses think of you?
I hope so.
Lee, are there any horses that you have a particularly close relationship with? You know, I remember...
What are you insinuating?
Well, I'm not insinuating anything, Lee, but when I was training Rooting King, my I used to allow the king to come into the house and he's such an engaging fella, you know what I mean? You'd wake up and there'd be Rooting King there waking up. And I'd just say, cup of coffee, thanks, king, for brekkie. And off he'd clippity-clop, bap, make a cup of tea. Do you get that close, or a cup of coffee? I often didn't make what I wanted. But do you get that close to horses, Lee?
Freud would have something to say about you.
Well, Freud would have something to say about people who train people to hit horses too, Lee.
No, actually, yeah, there's probably only been maybe two horses I've been really close to.
Yes.
What, this week or in your entire life? I'm gonna
regret that.
Who were they, Lee? And are they still with us?
They still
correspond.
Yeah, we're good friends. You know? Yeah. No, Superimpose, I think, and Scalacci were probably two of the horses that I, you know, really had a lot of time for. I mean, there's a lot of horses come through the stable that we're very close to, but they were two particular horses that we...
And were they special right from the off, or was it a tricky relationship in the first few years and then you gradually learned to like each other and, more importantly,
yeah,
respect each other?
Yeah. You know, a few dinners, that's all.
Yes, that's right. Now, look, speaking of Superimpose, we've got him running second in a very disappointing Melbourne Cup here, which Terrific ran,
yes,
won. Now, as you watch these races, Lee, for the first time, obviously you've seen this a million times in replay, are you emotionally attached to these horses as they run around? Like, would you like Superimpose to be in a better position, say, than Terrific, which is the outside horse gaining the upper hand in the shadows of the post here?
Well, actually, there's a good story involved with that. Superimpose was obviously the favourite horse in the stable at that time, and when he hit the front, I thought, great, I'm going to win my first Melbourne Cup. And I was standing with my lovely wife, Janelle, and she said, no, we're going to get beaten. And I can't actually say what I said.
And then we with duck?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I've been caught out saying it on this programme before, as you may have read in the papers.
I said we're fire trucked, and yes, and the other horse was actually ours too, so that was an amazing day, yeah.
But when it runs along, you know, do you think, oh, God, why isn't the jockey doing this? Oh, God, you know, you're biting your fingers nailed down.
I do.
Yeah, right.
I do, and I've actually come up with a scheme to circumvent all that. We're going to actually get radio mic contact with jockeys.
Yes.
Which would be quite interesting. I think you'd find that interesting.
I'd like that. How hard do you like jockeys to hit horses, Lee? Do you have them training? I mean, do you train the jockeys as much as you train the horses?
Oh, absolutely.
Hard do you like... Do you like them really bloody well belted? Do you like to see just a bit of mince with a beating heart come over the line? And do you have a look at the horse at the end of the run, scratch your head and say, well, he's hardly been hit at all?
The short answer to that is I don't know. I just think horses shouldn't probably be hit a lot with a whip. You know, most horses give their best, and we like to see them sort of minimal whipping.
Yes.
Jockeys, maximum whipping.
Yes. When Roy rode, of course, he developed a lot of other techniques apart from the whip to make them go fast. You know, he'd often reach down and grab hold of the cruets and give them, you know, things like that. Do you find that is encouraged in the Freedman camp?
You probably only get a third of the result you want because we've got geldings and fillies as well. So.
Yeah. No, I understand. Yeah. I was using that where appropriate, obviously.
Of course.
Now, let's have a look at another race. So I think this is the Villiers, one of our favourite races here on Club Buggery, and it's Kabora's win. And I must say, the handicapper did a tremendous job here. He got these horses almost to finish in a dead line. Kabora on the outside there, just getting the upper hand in the shadowed space. Terrific. And now, the Villiers... obviously very close to Christmas, so it doesn't get the prominence it deserves. Would that be a fair comment?
Oh, I think that's probably a very fair comment. You know, there's some great miles run at Randwick, the Doncaster and the Epsom and that, and the Villiers is you know, just that notch down, and I think Christmas sort of takes a bit away from it.
Yes. And can I put it to you that Sydney racing has had its ups and downs, you know, with jockeys and so on, which we might like to talk about a little bit, but further to that, I put it to you that there's a lot of bludging horses in Sydney. There's a lot of evil horses in Sydney. Until we get a horse, the stewards ask a horse to come in and stand on the spot and explain why it failed to run while it failed to win this race. We are never going to get anywhere with Sydney racing. It's always going to be a cesspit of problems because the horses are the problems and not the jockeys or the trainers or the connections. I put it to you, Lee Freedman, that you've got to stand up along with Nick Collum, who's here in the audience tonight, and say, bugger it, we've had enough. We want the horses to answer to some of these races. When we look at the stewards' field, the head-on shots, is it the jockeys causing the interference? Of course it isn't. It's the horses. And if there were no horses, there'd be no interference.
And I
know you agree 100% with that.
I couldn't agree more.
It would be so much easier without horses at all. Just jockeys running around, just little blokes hitting themselves. Do you admire the skill of Harry White? Do you admire the skill, say, of someone who can pull a horse just as hard this hand and hit it just as hard that hand, so the horse gets very confused, i.e. being pulled back this way and being belted back? Do you admire those sorts of skills, Lee?
It sounds a lot like marriage, actually.
Well, and are there special... I noticed some races you run clockwise and other races anti-clockwise. Are there clockwise specialists and anti-clockwise specialists? And have you got, you know, some specifically stamped anti-clockwise, others specifically stamped clockwise?
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Name a good clockwise one.
Flying Spur.
Flying Spur!
And Baryshnikov is a good one going the other way.
Correct.
And how do you pick it? Does that just have a natural lean? You see him in the stable...
It's true. Like humans, Roy, as you would understand, there's some horses have their legs longer than others and shorter, and, you know, that's...
Is that it? Yeah. Really?
No, it's my theory.
Oh, you're...
Speaking of Baryshnikov, I did see a fellow trainer, a fellow colleague of yours, say that the horse told him everything. And I thought, you know, told
it's
him...
It's a worry.
Yes, it is. I didn't know what to think of this, you know, as a comment. What I think he meant was that the horse felt as though he knew a lot about the racing cave because he was a racehorse, and that a human had no bugger all, really. And so that this horse was able to tell how far he wanted to run that day, how far, you know, how much he wanted to eat, what he wanted to weigh and so on. Is that a bit far-fetched?
It's absolutely correct. And that's where the punters get into trouble. That's absolutely where the punters get into trouble, yes. You know. Not knowing what the horse wants to do on the day.
How can you pick what a horse likes with its diet? I mean, with Rooting King really loved it. he loved a pint of beer and a couple of fried eggs on toast.
It's only him.
With a little bit of Worcestershire. Do you have special diets for specific horses? Like, see, Scalacci, well, let's have a few oats and a bit of the salt lick.
A lot of pasta,
is that right?
Scalacci, no.
Yeah, sure, the Italian connection. But is that how it is? Do they have specific diets or not?
Being serious, they have virtually the same diet in different amounts. And some horses are a bit allergic to some things and other horses aren't. But basically it's the same diet in different amounts.
How do you tell if they're allergic? Do they break out in a rash or...?
Or die.
Speaking of which, when you buy one, you know it's a dud. You know, it's an old, slow, clippity-clopper. Do you tap them on the head or... blow them away or... What do you do with them, Lee?
No, I think when you buy them, you actually tap yourself on the head. So why did I do that?
Have you ever had to put one down?
We have, yeah, unfortunately. It's a very sad thing. Yeah, it's a very sad...
How do you break it at the connections? Very slowly, I suppose. Hello, Mr. Sheik.
Your horse is dead.
Can I... Can I ask about the connections when you rang up a number of them and said, look, hello, Lee Freedman here, look, you might have noticed in the paper, we won't go into it, but I can't train the horses anymore. Michael will be taking over. Did that bother any of them?
No. Mercifully, no. They were our clients were fantastic, and they accepted the situation really well. And you know, for that we're eternally grateful.
And the other thing was, what happens when the connections bring around a horse, big wraps on it, straight from the sale yards? They back down the float into the driveway there of the stables. They lower down the back of the float. Out trots this absolute dud. What do you think, Melbourne Cup in that? You know, and you have to scratch your head and pretend. Look for the positives. It's got four legs and a tail. I'd see the crew at there.
Come inside and have a drink.
Yeah, right.
And can you pick them easily, Lee? What do you look for? Do you look for a straight back or a sway back? Do you look for strong legs? Do you look at the calves? Do you look at, do you have a look with a torch down the nostrils? What do you look
for?
What
did you look for in Reading King?
I looked for speed.
Mm. It's a good start.
Yeah.
No, we look for athletes. Same as human beings, yeah. Very much, the good horses are athletic.
Roy, I think when he was training, it's fair to say, pioneered the use of the salt lick in training. He brought that back into popularity.
Yep.
Been off the scene for
tried and true method.
50 years.
Yeah.
Roy added a couple of extra things to it, which the stewards didn't like, but never mind, this is a separate story. Now, are there ideas left to discover about horses, or is it just a refinement of the process, meaning... I noticed weight was a big thing a while ago, that horses had to weigh a certain amount.
Mm-hmm.
But are there any breakthrough ideas left? Say, as Chinese athletes have discovered, that rabbit fungus, or the fungus scraped off rabbit droppings.
Yes,
that's right. It's a terrific thing.
Yeah.
Are there big breakthroughs to be made?
I don't think so. I think the biggest breakthrough that will probably be made with horses, and I don't know if it ever will be made, is to get into their heads.
Oh,
and if you can work out what's happening there, and train them by what their head's saying, then I think some people can.
And look, we can't let you go without some selections for the spring.
Mm-hmm.
You obviously got a stable.
This isn't one of them.
No, I understand. That's for the winter, that one.
Of course.
It's won a lot of races for a lot of people, that one. It's very, very good.
Feeling good.
Yeah, that's right. Now, some thoughts on what's stacked in the stable for the coming spring, vis-a-vis, say, your cups and your cocks, of course, and maybe the billiers too, if you can look that far.
Just three horses that you'll be betting on.
Well, you can't go past your Flying Spur.
Flying Spur.
The owners are here. I can't say anything else.
The clockwise specialist or anti-clockwise specialist, yep.
Correct. No, you can't go past Flying Spur. I think Dennis Singer, horse.
Yeah.
And I think... a horse called Doremus, very good horse too.
Doremus, well,
you're not going to be persuaded by the connections aren't going to persuade you to let Flying Spur go to America, are they? I noticed that's been reported in the paper.
Well, it's on the plans, yeah.
Oh, it'll get killed.
Yeah.
I wouldn't do it, Lee. But we wish you all the best.
And on that sad note, it's time to ask all Club Buggery viewers, whether they're here in the showroom or there at home, to get them out and bang them and thank Lee Freedman. I believe getting into the horse's head is the way to go.
Well, if anyone can do it, Lee can.
Indeed. Did you ever think...
He'll be in with a scalpel.
Yeah, just having a look.
Take the brain out, because that's the last thing bloody horses need.
Right, thinking. Look, let's face it, ladies and gentlemen, we make an enormous amount of cash here each week with the cavalcade of cash and monkey madness by taking in a lot more than we give out in prizes. And Roy's had a lot of money in his kick, and he's begun refurbishing the club totally.
Yeah.
And Roy, you've been out spending this week, and we've got something to show not only the people here in the showroom, but everyone there at home. Have a look at what Roy's done with the cash this week. Just come this
just
way.
Just come and have a look, Casey. This is an absolute beauty.
Yes.
I think we should reveal now. Please, take it away.
Up it goes. Here it comes. Look at this.
This is your 1965 Nissan Cedric 1900. Listen to the note.
Listen to that for a note. It sings like a bird. It's got a horn that works. It has your electric aerial. Look at that, your aerial going up and down. That's standard in 1965. It's so comfortable, your beautiful bench seat. It goes like the clappers. It's only done 20,000. And on the last Club Buggery for 1995, yes, that's on the 13th of October.
13th of October.
Someone in the club is going to win this little beauty. It's a beautiful mint condition Nissan Cedric to be won on Club Buggery. So it'll be very, very lucky people who'll be in the club.
And I know a home where this would not look out of place. It's a home where extraordinary people do ordinary things. It's Ian's.
Club Buggery presents Ian, with Paul Sirenman as Ian, Lisa Forrest as Susan, Cole Joy as Ian's dad, Greg Matthews as Ian's friend Cole, Annette Shunwar as Susan's friend Deirdre, Ted Mulry as Bob the neighbour, Warren Boland as Cole's mate Pete, with special guest Barry Cassidy.
Oh, I don't know how it got there.
What did the police actually find on the boat, Bob?
2 ounces of marijuana under one of the bunks, apparently. Oh, that's so stupid.
Yeah, I'll say.
What's going to happen?
I'll tell you what's going to happen. He's going to go to jail. That's what's going to happen.
Oh, come on, Pops.
And he bloody well deserves to, also. Bloody drug addict.
Oh, Pops, that's not true. You never touch the bloody stuff.
Susan, Dad, this is Chief Inspector Brown. That's Bob there, Inspector Brown.
Thanks, Ian. So you're Bob.
Yes, Inspector Brown.
What's your principal address, Bob?
Next door.
And how much time do you think you'd spend there?
Just about all the time, wouldn't we, Dees?
So why aren't we conducting this interview next door, Bob?
Well, just that...
Why do you keep coming over here?
Because Ian and Susan are friends of ours.
And that gives you the right to barge in here whenever it suits you?
Hey, well, now, come on!
You shut up. Shut the f*** up.
Okay. Hi, all.
This is Chief Inspector Brown.
Oh.
And you are?
Pete.
I think I've seen your scummy mug before, Pete, and I don't want to see it again. And the same goes for your mate here, do you hear?
Sure. We hear you, man.
Okay, Bob and Deirdre. I'll let you off with a warning this time, but just remember, if it wasn't for Ian here and the wonderful work that he does on a current affair, you'd both be in the can. Do I make myself clear?
Yes, Inspector.
I'll let myself out. Nice meeting you, Susan. Dad? See you later, Ian.
Wow.
Gee, Ian, it's just such a searing indictment on the lives we lead, isn't it, boy? It's so brutal these days that it's hard to know how it's ever going to turn out well for all of them concerned. Gee,
yes, it's a black hole, isn't it?
It is indeed. Now, look, this week a new code of ethics was released for journalists. Journalists are people who write stories about things and create stories on the radio and television about things. And I'm just wondering if we could address this for a minute vis-a-vis sport. As a corollary to this, a prominent Canberra footballer, Ricky Stewart, said he went on a television show and lied because he basically hated, I understand, one of the presenters of the program. He lied because he didn't like the way that presenter was asking questions. He didn't like the way that journalist was responding to the things he'd done recently on the paddock. And I felt tonight we should address this new code of ethics vis-a-vis sport and ask a couple of searing questions. Firstly, Roy Slaven, how was it done in your day?
Yeah.
How did you handle the media?
Yeah.
And the other thing, is this new code of ethics mean that players in the future are going to have to be truthful, which I think would be a horrible state of affairs?
Yes. Actually, if we can... if we can just deal to begin with the duty of disclosure.
Yes.
I think that's it. You've got to know where a journalist is coming from. And I think you mentioned the footy show, I think, on Channel 9 in Sydney.
Yes.
And in Brisbane. And in that particular footy show, I think with each of the journalists on the program, say, P. Vaughton, there should be a strap that comes along and lets you know a little bit about them so you know where they're coming from, so that their questions are put in context. Oh, so with P. Vaughton, you have something like, P. Vorton, idiot, played for Manly, is employed by Kerry Packer and loves dressing up as a woman.
Oh, that's a terrific context.
And that puts his questions in context.
Yeah, I wish we could have that sort of thing on our show.
Well, indeed.
Roy Slaven, champion horse, trainer and jockey.
Yes, that's all you need.
When you've got Lee Freedman on, and then it would change. Somebody else might come on and you'd have Australian Rugby League players.
That's right. It puts it in context. Yeah, and the same with, say, Talk and Footy with Bruce McAvaney and Mike Sheehan.
Oh, yes.
Sheehan, you'd have a strap come across the road. Mike Sheehan works for Rupert Murdoch. Ideas ever had? None.
Yes, well,
and that puts it in context.
Yes.
Now, getting back to your original question, Grassy would get us together at the start of the year. Yeah. Grassy Grannell, our coach at the Presbytery.
Yes.
And because he wanted to train us in how to deal with the media, because, as he said, he didn't want us to look like idiots. He didn't want us to look like idiots. So he trained. So he'd say, Roy, you've just been in a team that's won. What are you going to say to the media? And he trained us to say things like, and I can remember now, say something like, it was a terrific win. We all played real well. We put in 110%, and hats off to the opposition. They were terrific. They really put it up to us out there today, but unfortunately they weren't good enough on the day because they only put in 100%. But hats off to them. They had hearts as big as Farlap, but not as big as the hearts we had. And I look forward to meeting them again because they're a champion side. No risk, no worries. And I'd just like to thank our sponsors, that is Finley's Furniture Arcade, Finley's for Fine Furniture, and Bracey's. They're terrific people to deal with. You know what I mean?
I do. And when you've got a follow-up question along the lines of how you're seeing the rest of the year, it was a week-by-week...
week-by-week proposition. So there's no truth.
Yes.
But then again, when it comes to football, you can't have truth because you can't bring the game into disrepute.
No.
You get fined. If I was to say, well, rugby league is corrupt. The AFL is corrupt. It's corrupt as buggery. Just watch the footy show to see how bloody well corrupt it is. See those ambushes happening on your poor, hapless Super League players when they get on there. Have a look at the work of Hanley and that other corrupt bunch. Have a look at the refereeing standards that plummeted, etc., etc. But if you say things like that, you're fined $10,000 for bringing the game to the script. So, you cannot have truth in reporting.
Roy, you know, in this day and age, do you think it's wise for players to go back to the sort of thing that you were taught by Grass in the Presbytery there all those years ago?
I think so.
Yes.
I think, well, when you lose, it's, well, we only put in 95%. And, you know, Coach Grannell has really been working us hard with ball work, but we ignored all we'd been told out there today. And we're just idiots to ourselves, and we'll go back to the room of mirrors and spend a good time looking at ourselves for the rest of the week, and hopefully we can bounce back better next week. But hats off to Orange Sims, they're just a better team on the day out there. And thanks very much, and I'd like to thank the sponsors, Finley's Furniture. You know.
Well, we've certainly got a fine future to look forward to with this new code of ethics and Mike Sheehan's in-depth reporting on the AFL. And now a woman who never needs injury time because she has it in the bag from the off. Ladies and gentlemen, throw your caution to the wind and give a humongous poke-filled welcome to the Stones, the Cedrics and Ms. Jane Scully and their contribution to the festivities tonight here on this top-shelf card of Club Buggery. Why haven't I heard from you?
On a plane or in your car. So tell me why. Well, there's no problem getting to me, baby. You can die. you through. So dial 0 for assistance. If it all confuses you, so tell me why.
That Reba McEntire number, and sadly, the news broke tonight that Liz Taylor and Larry Fortensky, well, let's face it, I suppose I was going to say, haven't been able to see eye for eye for at least 6 minutes, and they've decided to call it quits.
Yes, they want their separate space.
Yes, yes.
I think they deserve their separate space, to be frank.
Yes.
I wish them all the best in the world.
And I think the other thing worthy of mention at this moment, Roy, is your magnificent work on the Danny Minogue Playboy shoot. As nearly as we can tell, Danny is revitalising her career by letting Roy snap some 60,000 rolls of film, from which six will be selected to go in the next month's Playboy. How difficult a job was this, Roy?
Look, can I just say, I think it's a very brave move on Danny's behalf. I thought the marriage to Julian was a brave career move, and I think this is even braver. Look, it took her a little while to relax, because it's not an easy thing to do.
No.
You know, you've got to take your trousers off, and then your top, and then you move on to other bits and pieces, and then you've got to flounce about in the buff with someone taking snaps. And for a lot of kiddies, that can be a very disconcerting experience.
Yes.
But after about 80 hours, I think Danny was starting to relax a little.
I thought the first...
It's not easy to do, you know, just to sit buffed and pretend you're natural.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Pretend you're having fun.
Yes.
I was going to say, the first 40,000 rolls, well, I had a look at them, and they don't reveal much at all.
No.
And the other thing I think, Roy, is it's good news to see that after a success on the Big Breakfast program in England, that Danny now wants to do a little bit more political interviewing.
Is that right?
Yeah, I think she wants to take over from Kerry O'Brien on Late Line. Here.
Does she?
I think that could work.
Well, that'd be great, because I know Kerry wants to move on into modelling.
And now... It's time to welcome a man who makes his quid singing as loud as buggery. Nissan Cedric, can you get out the day glow pavement paint? And on the nearest parking lot, touch up the Jimmy Barnes story.
Wake up, listen to me now, every one of you. This is a man.
Jimmy Barnes.
Yes, Jimmy Barnes. It's our Jimmy. Jimmy Barnes.
you brought the family along tonight, Jimmy.
I did, mate. Yes. Right.
Now, look, on the ABC programming at the moment, we're following a show by Billy Connolly, his world tour of Scotland.
Right.
I don't suppose you've had a chance to see this
No,
programme.
I heard it's pretty funny, though.
Well, it's very, very good, and I was just wondering if watching programmes like that tug at the heartstrings at all.
Yeah, it does, actually. Billy, you know, hanging out with the Scotsman, I immediately sort of feel like nipping home to Glasgow.
Now, you're living in France at the moment, and I must say, this move does surprise me somewhat, because when I think of rock and roll and the sort of work you do, I don't think French.
No.
Plastic Bertrand. Yeah, Plastic Bertrand.
What's that song he had up?
Avec...
C'est bon vous plaît.
Yeah, well, one of those, yeah. Yes,
that's right. Well, you wouldn't call that sort of...
No.
Rock.
Well, that's why I went there, you know? Yeah. Because I can hang there and not actually do anything. The best thing about living in France is, you know, nobody knows who I am, so I can sort of, you know, walk around the street, you're wearing stupid clothes and, you know, without worrying about it, riding my bike with the, you know, the dumb hat and all that sort of stuff.
Is there any talk of the bomb there at all, Jimmy? Is there
any what?
Talk of the nuclear bomb at Mururoa? I mean, are people concerned in the province where you're staying?
Well, they do, because they're really concerned, because actually they all voted for Chirac when he said, you know, we're not bloody, you know, get back in, we're not going to test anything, we're not going to put VAT up. First two things he did was announce the tests and put VAT up, so they all hate him.
Basically. They hate him.
And how do you get on with French? Obviously, you've got Scottish down pretty well, but you know, how's your French?
The Scottish was natural, I don't know. Yeah, no. The French is it's horrible, mate. You know?
And when you go out and you want a cafe au lait, if that's
exactly
the right term,
what I say.
A croque monsieur.
That's exactly
right. You know, they understand, or they just look at you quizzically and think, oh, no, not another bloke.
Yeah,
another
Scotsman, yeah. No, they're okay. I can sort of make do, but it's, you know, it's pretty basic. You know? My kids all speak French, though. I think they're actually, you know, they start to talk more French than English, so they don't have to talk to me.
Yeah. It is interesting, talking about language, Jimmy, because you left Scotland when you were six.
Yeah, yeah.
You went to South Australia, mm-hmm. Where you spent very, you
did
know,
you
large part... Yeah,
you
that's for you.
That
yeah,
way,
that's yeah? for you. We'll yes, get to drinking right. in a minute.
All right. Thanks very much.
Now,
that's the, best
the accent has never left you. Now, we have Greg Norman, you know, been in Australia for a long time, went to America for 3 months and he started sounding like an American. Now, how come you've still retained the brogue?
I don't know. I grew up in a place called Elizabeth, which is outside Adelaide, and basically it's a satellite city where they decided they're going to stick all the immigrants in there together. And, you know, I grew up there, and I, you know, didn't know any Australians until I was about 14, and that was only when we used to go outside Elizabeth to beat them up, you know?
Yes.
So. Yeah. Well, it's very
soccer
Scottish.
Religions, you know,
it's a Scottish thing, fighting, isn't it?
Do you
still enjoy a fight, Jimmy?
I haven't had a fight in hours. But I'm ready for one.
Yeah, I
know, I heard about this. So I was prepared, you know, tonight. I trained and pumped up a bit before I came out.
Yeah.
No, I, you know, I don't like fighting.
Look, you're here promoting Cyclone, the new CD and so on. Is this recorded in France?
It was.
Now, how does that work? You know, obviously you've got a worldwide audience. You know, are the French up to speed with, you know, your rock? Demands, technology, you know.
Oh, yeah, no, they've got great studios. The studio we cut that in is actually, you know, AC/DC recorded there. Mm-hmm. Pink Floyd did The Wall there. So, I mean, they've got all the gear. They just don't know how to bloody sing.
Basically. Yeah. Yes, that's right. I think that's fair.
You know, they should have my visa.
We should have an exit.
Yes, this is the first single off Cyclone, and I think it's called Change of Heart. Here's Jimmy at work.
Now, Jimmy, was that filmed? It didn't look as if it was filmed in France. Where was that filmed?
It was filmed in Paris.
Was it in Paris? Really?
Yeah. With an Italian film director, though, so it made it look more Italian.
Oh, right.
Now, do you ever...
I don't know how, but...
Do you ever get sort of mixed, you know, in the ideas? Obviously, the record's made for English-speaking people. You know, a lot of people in Australia want to buy it. Well, that's the audience that you imagine. Or is it now, for you, just a world stage on which to draw?
That's a serious question. No, you just make records. You make the best record you can make, and it doesn't matter where you're making a record for, you know, Iceland or for, you know, France or for anywhere. Mm. Basically, you just get up and, you know, hopefully, you know, do something that works. Otherwise, you know, you soon find out.
What was it like working with the Stones?
Oh, well, you know, you've worked with them.
Yes, we've worked with them. But with the pretend Stones.
Well, the other guys.
Yeah, the other guys.
What were they like?
It
was okay. It was a funny thing, actually, because the... You know, the backstage, it wasn't like sort of like, you know, you get in there and sort of, hey, Keith, how you going, rubbing shoulders? Yeah, the backstage with the Stones is like, you know, it's maximum security, you know? Mm. And, but we sort of get in there and sort of, you know, kicked a bit of ass and basically just took over the place. So, they, you know, we went down well. I think that probably the most intimidating thing was the size of the stage, you know?
Yeah.
The stage was, like, ridiculous. You know, it looks like a small city. But, you know, I just got, you know, had a few vodkas and went nuts and had a good time, basically. Yeah.
And you get even with the Stones, you get a third of the PA and one or two lights. And,
No, they didn't give us any lights, but they gave us all the PA.
Yeah.
I think the Stones are above all that sort of rubbish, you know. There's not many, the only bands that I've ever seen that actually cut back your, like, you know, give you shitty PA and all that are the bad bands, you know. And the Rolling Stones are, you know, far too good for that.
Yeah.
But, you know, obviously there's a lot of stuff they had that they couldn't let us use, you know, the snake and all that sort of shit. You know?
Yeah, what a pity. Would have been great to use the snake.
I was thought about coming in on it, yeah.
Yeah, well, we try to get the snake for tonight. Now, Jimmy, in the old days when you used to drink a bottle of whiskey and a bottle of Drambuie in an hour and a half on stage, do you miss those days?
I can't remember those days.
No, it wasn't.
When was that? I got to the end of a couple of those shows, and I don't remember the ends of the shows, and I think I sort of destroyed the PA, and, you know, I'd be sort of dead on the floor, and my liver would be running around doing songs by itself, you know? Not really.
Yeah. Did the band members worry about you? Like,
they
you
didn't know.
Jimmy was
carrying on. They were so pissed, they didn't know, you know? it was part of the, you know, thing. It was just wild, and, you know, basically I drank as quick as I could so they couldn't stop me, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Matt Monro enjoys...
Honey
and
Walk away.
Yes, that's right. He did another one too, which I can't quite remember.
Around the World in 80 Days.
Oh, he might have done that.
He
enjoys lemon and honey now to ease the larynx.
Yeah.
Did you find that Drambuie and whiskey did that for you?
It didn't help the voice at all, but I didn't give a damn anyway. Yeah? No, basically, the worst thing for a singer, the worst thing that can happen is you get nervous. You know, it's like, you know, you can have a, you know, fine form with your voice. If you get nervous, you clam up. So I find actually, you know, as much as a joke about it, having a drink actually I just relax, so I don't give a damn, basically. And once you get to that point, then, you know, you're relaxed, you can sing.
Yeah. And writing, you're enjoying writing, because you're writing a lot more now than you were before. Yeah,
I like writing. You know, it's something that I've sort of learned to do as it went along. My wife's writing with me now, which is great, so, you know.
And in France, how easy is it to find out, you know, things about Australia? I mean, you know, like, say, football scores or, you know, things
like that. I actually sort of snuck out. I got Sky, you know, TV over there, so, that, you know, they play the rugby once a week and they get, you know, the AFL and all that sort of stuff. But, you know, there's a shop in my, you know, town that sells Vegemite and all that sort of stuff, so it's cool. Foster's.
Is that right?
Anybody who wants to drink Foster's, you can drink.
Oh, well, France, they've gone Australia mad.
they'd love to blow their face
off. That's right.
And now with Jimmy Barnes' help, it's time to play Who's This Very Interesting Australian Artiste. But first, before we get Roy and the contestant, the prizes. And a tremendous prize lineup again. We've got this magnificent Ian plate. I don't know whether Jimmy's seen these. Not available at the shop near his. It's featured the cast of Ian. Plus that, certificate of authentication. And do be wary of plates without their certificate of authentication. I can't vouch for them at all.
Sydney 2000 logo.
Yeah,
that. And of course the Club Buggery t-shirt, as seen on the catwalks of France recently. The Paris catwalks in time for Father's Day, you can still get some of those. Plus, something that's only available in Australia, they're not for export, you have to live here to own them, the Browns, the classics there. And because it's footy final season, a couple of tickets to the St George Canterbury match this weekend. I hope we can show those. And we might get Jimmy to sign or autograph his cyclone.
Yeah.
Have a go at that. But wait till Roy sets out the...
Yes, you can make it out, Jimmy, to my very good friend Michael, because it's Michael McIlwain's birthday with us this evening. Michael, where are you?
Hey.
Welcome to the club,
Michael. Yes.
Good to see you. To Michael. Now, Jimmy, what you've got to do is identify this very famous Australian celebrity at work. Have a bit of a look now. Here she is. It's a high-energy act.
I tell you what, that's Jackie Love.
That's Jackie Love!
Jackie Love.
Yeah, there she is again. Yes.
Jackie Love.
I think Jackie went to Vegas with Sammy Davis Jr. Yeah, she came back. Sammy didn't.
And on that wonderful note, it's time to wish Jimmy all the very best with his career in France and ask Club Buggery viewers, whether they're at home or here in the showroom, to get him out and start banging them and thank Jimmy Barnes! Jimmy, Jimmy, Jimmy. So now on Club Buggery, it's time to do a Dino, a segment in which we ask a prominent sporting identity to perform a song made famous by the great, great Dean Martin. And we do this in celebration of all those players who won't be playing in the finals this year in 1995. Let's face it, a lot of players have fallen by the wayside through injury. And let's face it, the club isn't thinking about you anymore. The fans aren't thinking about you anymore. Your teammates aren't thinking about you anymore. But Club Buggery is. I don't want to take this too far. That's enough. The performance tonight is timely because this player has been sidelined from the finals and sadly missing from his team this evening. The song, Georgia, the performer, Greg Florimo.
Georgia, Georgia, the whole day through, just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind. Georgia on my mind, Georgia, oh Georgia. A song of you comes as sweet and clear as moonlight through the pines. Other arms reach out to me, other eyes smile oh so tenderly. Still in peaceful dreams I see the road leads back to you. Just that old sweet sound keeps Georgia on my mind. Georgia on my mind.
You're here live on Club Buggery in the 1965 Nissan Cedric 1900 showroom.
And Club Buggery has a tradition of bringing you the finest in overseas artistes. This tradition has been going on for the best part of 15 years. We continue it tonight with a rendition of Flame Trees. Come up and have a spit, Jimmy Burns!
Number two is a happy hour.
and one off to hotels and settle into a lady you remember so and so. And number three is never say her name. And oh, the fade trees went a weary drive. You know, it takes more than just a memory to make me cry. And I'm happy just to sit here round this table with old friends and see which one of us can tell the biggest lies.
Obviously gone but not forgotten here on Club Buggery. And now, Roy, look, a very hard act to follow, but I think we can do it.
Oh, no, it's not. No, we can top that.
Okay, I'll bugger it. Let's get it up. Here it is, ladies and gentlemen. When Lee Freedman was with us earlier this evening, he picked out a couple of people which he gave the nod to vis-a-vis those who had made those extra hard yards appearance-wise tonight in Club Buggery. And Roy, what have we got for them?
I can't tell you the difficulty I've had getting this one. It was so quick.
Oh, so great.
It was so quick. I managed to bag it
about an hour ago.
Well, no, about an hour and a half ago. I've been bleeding it ever since, and I think it's right to go now. It is. And it was a terrific little bugger.
It had a personality, this one, and I'm sure you'll taste it when you eat it.
It was a real, you're right, a real personality pig. Now, we've got the apple here, but I think as a garnish, you cannot go past both the apple and the love apple in the day. It always works. Now,
before you go, of course, There's a Barnsley CD. And Tom, this year here, two magnificent tickets. No, four magnificent tickets to the footy finals this weekend. I think it's the Canterbury St George match there for those in the Sydney area.
Yep.
But who is the recipient of this magnificent try?
This will keep them fed for a month, HG. Congratulations, you've gone to so much trouble. Here we are. Good on you. Look at that. All the best. Thanks for coming along. Enjoy it.
And tonight's meat tray provided by the Clive Hale Abattoir, Port Lincoln, where they put the beast to rest the way you like best. And now we've come to the, sadly, to the end of another show.
Yes.
Have you got some results there, Roy? You have two. What happened in the rugby league tonight?
In the quarterfinal, I suppose it'd be a quarterfinal, wouldn't it?
Well, sort of.
Final of sorts. Newcastle 20, North 10.
And in the AFL, Brisbane 16-14, 110 beat Melbourne 13-11, 89. Which means that Brisbane may well go on and play in the eight in the AFL. And in the WNBL Grand Final tomorrow night, Adelaide is taking on Melbourne. And in the NBL, the men's code, Newcastle versus Adelaide. What happened there, Roy?
Yes, Adelaide 100, Newcastle 91. Bad luck, Falcons.
And in Geelong 127 Townsville, they failed to take the journey down to Geelong, only 113. And Roy, where are you off to this weekend?
Well, actually, I think I'll be going to the WNBL Grand Final. That's the Adelaide v Melbourne. I'll certainly be at that one. And then I'll come back, and I'm just going to go to the Earlwood Bardwell Park RSL Club. I love it there. It's just a seafood night. You just bring along whatever seafood you can find, a bit of sea junk, take it along, and you can cook it up there. And the Bob Henderson Quartet will be playing as well. And nobody swore they can fire up seafood. Bob Henderson. Even if the seafood's off, it tastes beautiful. It goes down with the quartet.
Last week I had such a terrific night at Silver's down at Traction at Turak Road. And the MC there, Michael Roberts, gee, did a good job.
Did you get a fight?
I did.
Obviously you did.
There was lots of celebrity footballers down there, and I had a go at most of them. Some, of course, obviously I missed. Others are connected with, and tomorrow night it's more of the same. And I'm taking... I know this will sound a bit odd. I'm taking Ian Turby's mother-in-law along with me, Constant Nelly, because it's her birthday.
Yes.
She comes from Surratt, just outside Roma, and I think we're going to have a terrific time, Constance Nelly, on your birthday.
But so it'll be a real Father's Day weekend.
I think so.
Father's Day weekend. And don't forget that Cedric competition on the 13th.
Well,
someone will be...
And now, Roy, look, we can't go through the highlights. We haven't got time. There's been too many anyway. It's just been wall-to-wall highlights. But I think we saved the best till last. He's been out in the Imperial Peking, in under the baton of Johnny Lim, the maestro at the Lychee Lounge here at Club Buggery. And he's had a go at something that I've never seen him do. Uncooked. He's gone uncooked tonight.
Has he?
Limmy was a bit shocked when he just said, don't bother cooking it.
Yes.
Just give me the MSG, that'll do. But I think he's ready. He's here, the giant of the G-Cord, the man who owns his own shirt, the come on down man, Ian Taps Tappy. See you next week.
You're up fine.
February.
You're my little Valentine.
March.
I'm gonna march you down the aisle.
April.
You're the Easter bunny when you smile. Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
My heart's in a whirl. I love, I love, I love my little calendar girl. Every day,
every day,
every day of the year. Maybe I'll ask your dad and mom if I can take you to the junior prom. Like a firecracker all the glow. When you're on the beach, you steal the show. Yeah, yeah, my heart's in a whirl. I love, I love, I love my little calendar girl. Every day,
every day
of the year.
Every day of the year.
What you do?
September.
16. Romeo and Juliet or Halloween.
November.
I'm gonna thank the world that you are me. Oh,
December.
You're the present beneath my Christmas tree. Yeah,
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 yeah.
My heart's in a whirl.
I love, I love, I love my little.